knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
When you imagine crime scene investigation, what is the first thing that comes into your mind? It might be a detective with a magnifying glass, or some barricading tape with the words, "Crime scene, do not cross." Or it might be fingerprints. This is not surprising, because fingerprints are the most commonly found evidence at a CS. Touch just about anything, anywhere, without gloves on, of course, and you'll leave a fingerprint pattern there. You might argue that DNA is the most common evidence recovered from a CS, and yes, that would be correct. DNA can be extracted from almost any biological evidence present at the CS. However, there are bigger factors at play. A DNA sample requires extensive processing for recovery and analysis, costing about 400 to 500 times more than the analysis of a fingerprint. Moreover, it might take months to obtain the results of DNA analysis, depending on the specimen, but fingerprints have no such limitations. Additionally, a pair of identical twins share the same DNA, but they don't share the same set of fingerprints, which makes a fingerprint the cheapest and most reliable evidence for identification. Though a fingerprint might not be visible to the naked eye on some surfaces, there have been so many advancements in fingerprint science that a fingerprint can be recovered from almost any surface in existence. Studying fingerprints and their recovery for a person's identification is a branch of science known as dermatoglyphics. This is derived from two words, derma, which means skin, and glyph, which means carving. So dermatoglyphics is the study of skin carving. However, the term skin carving is not exclusive to fingerprints, but rather is inclusive of all other patterns exhibited by our palms, soles, and toes. Our main focus will be on fingerprints, not only because they are the most common, but also because the techniques of recovery for all other patterns are similar to those of fingerprints. As a piece of evidence found at the CS, fingerprints are exceptionally important for two reasons. One, every fingerprint is unique to an individual. And two, fingerprints remain the same throughout a person's life unless the dermal layer of skin is permanently damaged. Identification of a person from their fingerprints generally involves identification of the overall pattern followed by individualization of the pattern. We will talk about this in the next few tutorials in great detail, but first, let's look at the fascinating history of fingerprints and their study. The use of fingerprints or palm prints for a person's identification actually dates back thousands of years. Fingerprint-like patterns have been observed on many archaeological artifacts, such as pots, utensils, and seals in ancient Greece and China. Fingerprints have also been observed on walls of Egyptian tombs. Craftsmen may have used fingerprints as a way to sign their work, thus authenticating them. Clay tablets with fingerprint patterns imprinted on them were used in ancient Babylon to validate business transactions, thus protecting them from forgery. As opposed to today, materials like paper, ink, and writing instruments were not readily available to authenticate a transaction by signature, so they took advantage of the fact that the patterns on your hand are your ready-made stamps. It is quite interesting that people back then actually realized the uniqueness of these patterns and used them for authenticating things. Gradually, law enforcement in ancient Babylon and China started using fingerprints for the identification of criminals as well. Documentation from the era of the Babylonian king Hammurabi indicates that records were kept of arrested criminals by fingerprinting them. Around 300 CE in China, fingerprints were authorized to be used as a piece of evidence for investigation in cases involving theft. Before this development, criminals were identified in most civilizations by either branding or maiming them, where the former involves applying hot iron on a person's skin, while the latter involves cutting off the nose or hands of the criminal. Fingerprinting surely was a welcome change in this regard. While fingerprints were used as proof of identity in some parts of China as early as 300 BCE, other civilizations followed suit later, such as Japan in 702 CE and Persia in the 14th century, while the United States joined hundreds of years later. It was in 1902 that fingerprints were adopted as a means of identification in the US. Fingerprint science was highly developed by then, with a proper pattern classification system in place. Let's learn about the pioneers who made substantial contributions to fingerprint science. Nehemiah Grew, an English scientist widely known for his work on the anatomy of plants, is widely acknowledged as the first person to study and describe ridges, furrows, and pores on hand and foot surfaces. In 1684, he published accurate drawings of these skin patterns. Marcello Malpighi, who is referred to as the founder of microscopical anatomy, histology, and the father of physiology and embryology, was a contemporary of Nehemiah Grew. It has been reported that both Malpighi and Grew often freely borrowed from one another as they shared a common interest in microscopical studies. Malpighi observed fingerprints using the microscope and documented the common characteristics of different fingerprint patterns. With regards to his contributions, a 1.88mm layer of human skin came to be known as the Malpighi layer. In 1823, a thesis was published by John Evangelist Purkinje, which described a total of 9 different fingerprint patterns. One thing to note here is that none of these early pioneers extended their studies further and were limited in scope. The microscope was one of the most important inventions back then, and fingerprints would just have been a convenient sample to observe even under lower magnification. Therefore, though the early pioneers recorded their observations on fingerprints, they did not comment on other important aspects, such as their unique and permanent nature. This indicates that the identification of a person using fingerprints was not under scientific consideration for a long time in modern history. It was the early 1800s when Thomas Buick published a book and signed it using his thumbprint. This gentleman was primarily a wood engraver, and he started imprinting his other works using his thumbprint as well, believing it was unique to himself. Hermann Welker, a German anthropologist, hypothesized that fingerprints do not change in structure throughout life. To prove this, he took his own set of fingerprints twice, 40 years apart, once in 1856 and again in 1897. Expectedly, Welker observed no difference between the two sets, following which he published a study to establish the permanent nature of fingerprints. Let's move over to the eastern part of the world. Sir William Herschel was a British administrator in the Bengal province in India, who later went on to join the Indian Civil Services. While working in his official capacity, Herschel entered into a transaction with a local businessman and asked him to put a handprint on the back of the document. Years later, recounting this practice, Herschel would refer to himself as the first person to use fingerprints for identification. However, this claim is not true, as authorizing business transactions by signing them and adding a handprint or a fingerprint was fairly standard practice in that part of India. Nevertheless, Herschel's contribution cannot be ignored, as he was the first person to include fingerprints in official government transactions. He started using fingerprints as a tool to detect frauds and false impersonations in official work such as pension and salary distribution. Realizing the utility of fingerprints, Herschel tried to concretely establish their use in the administration. However, he was unsuccessful in convincing the officials above him, and his vision was never fulfilled. Nonetheless, just like Hermann Welker, Sir William Herschel went on to demonstrate the permanent nature of fingerprints by studying his own patterns over 50 years. Shortly after, Dr. Henry Faulds, a Scottish clinician, missionary, and scientist, visited India in 1871 and noted the use of fingerprints in authenticating business transactions. In the following year, he visited Japan and eventually settled as a superintendent at an important hospital. Being a man of varied interests, he also got involved in archaeological excavations in Japan around the late 1870s. While studying ancient Japanese pottery, he observed the fingerprints imprinted on them and was amazed by the thought that even ancient civilizations valued fingerprints as a means of identification. This piqued Faulds' interest, and he studied fingerprints extensively to establish the unique nature of fingerprints. Soon after, his hospital was broken into. The police arrested a suspect who belonged to the hospital staff, whom Faulds believed was innocent. He compared the fingerprints found on the CS with those of the suspect. They were found to be different, and based on this evidence, the innocence of the staff member was established. This may well have been one of the first cases where fingerprints were analyzed in forensic investigation. Faulds, ambitious in promoting his research, wrote to Charles Darwin referring to his observations and seeking more insight, but Darwin was not interested in studying fingerprints. However, he forwarded the letter to his cousin, Francis Galton, who in turn forwarded the letter to the Anthropological Society of London. Years later, Galton started studying fingerprints on his own and failed to credit Faulds. As a result of this confusion, there has been a controversy related to the original inventor of modern forensic fingerprinting, although it is undeniable that the first paper related to the topic was published by Faulds in 1880. But the story is not over yet. After Faulds published this paper, Sir William Herschel, the former British administrator, wrote to the journal stating that he had been using fingerprints for identification since 1860, way before Faulds. One thing to note here is that though Herschel was the first to use fingerprints for identification officially, he did not venture into the potential of fingerprint analysis in forensic science. Faulds and Herschel were embroiled in a bitter quarrel for decades over the credit, which led to an enormous number of letters and proofs exchanged between them. Moreover, Galton also jumped in, supporting Herschel's claim for credit. It was not until 1917 when Herschel conceded that Faulds was the first to suggest the forensic use of fingerprints. Today, the forensic community generally regards Sir William Herschel as the first to introduce identification using fingerprints, Dr. Henry Faulds as the first to suggest forensic use, and Francis Galton as the first to study fingerprints with a scientific footing. Though modern pioneers like Herschel and Faulds initiated the discussion of utilizing fingerprints for identification, it was still a rudimentary science. Criminal identification at that time was based on photographs and visual memory. Law enforcement officers possessing extraordinary observation skills were hired to identify a previously captured criminal. The invention of photography made it easier to keep records of criminals, but it was unreliable, as personal appearances often change. To make the case for identification stronger, in 1880, a young French police officer came up with the idea of maintaining records of different bodily features by measuring them. Discovered by Alphonse Bertillon, this system came to be known as Bertillonage and was the first scientific method of criminal identification. It involved physical measurements such as head length, head breadth, length of the middle finger, length of the left foot, and length of the forearm. Bertillon proposed that a combination of these measurements was unique to each individual. He was also the inventor of mugshots, which were used collectively with anthropometric measurements to identify a criminal. We will learn about this system in detail when we examine forensic anthropology. So what does this have to do with fingerprints? Well, Alphonse Bertillon is a name that is always mentioned whenever fingerprint science is discussed. He did not contribute directly to the development of fingerprints, but his system led to a watershed event that enforced the need for a better system of identification. Dr. Henry Faulds once sent a letter to the Scotland Yard to offer his help in criminal identification using fingerprints, but this offer was rejected because the Bertillonage system was immensely popular and effective. It was a freak incident that brought fingerprints into the limelight. At a prison in Leavenworth, Kansas, a staff was taking measurements of a prisoner named Will West when he realized that he had encountered the same set of measurements before. When he went through the records, his assumptions were found to be true. There was a prisoner with a similar name, William West, who had the same set of measurements. Strangely, they also had similar facial features. Were they long-lost brothers? No, in fact. This one case proved the fallibility of three main factors considered for identification: names, photographs, and physical features. But what about their fingerprints? Obviously, no resemblance was observed in their fingerprint patterns. This incident highlighted the fact that Bertillonage is not a reliable test for criminal identification, and it convinced law enforcement that identification of fingerprints could be a superior method to Bertillonage. At this point, we come back to Francis Galton, who is remembered as one of the greatest scientists of the 19th century. He was a statistician, sociologist, psychologist, anthropologist, tropical explorer, geographer, inventor, meteorologist, protogeneticist, and psychometrician, though he was also a proponent of social Darwinism, eugenics, and scientific racism. As described before, he was also the one who studied fingerprints extensively on a scientific footing. Galton was involved with the development of Bertillonage for a long time. While doing his research, he came across Sir William Herschel's works on fingerprints and started working on them himself. In 1893, Galton proposed using fingerprints in conjunction with Bertillonage. He suggested that there are specific types of fingerprint patterns, and each fingerprint can be individualized by studying the unique minute features in the pattern. These features are now known as Galton details. Soon, the use of fingerprints overshadowed Bertillonage in criminal identification. We will study Galton's contribution in detail, as it requires a separate tutorial. It was because of his scientific research on fingerprints that fingerprints came to be accepted as reliable evidence for identification in the court of law. For the first time, a proper fingerprint classification based on Galton's work was devised in the 1890s by Sir Edward Henry in British India. In the process of developing this fingerprint classification system, Henry studied Galton's works and visited him personally. Galton reciprocated reciprocated by sharing everything he had researched, including the works of Herschel and Faltz. Due to Edward Henry's efforts to introduce his classification system in criminal investigation, the first fingerprint bureau in history was established in Calcutta, India, in the year 1897. Following its success in the criminal justice system, this system was adopted in the United Kingdom in 1899. We will also discuss Henry's classification system in detail in a separate tutorial. Eventually, the importance of the use of fingerprints in identification came to be realized worldwide. Today, the FBI has developed its own fingerprint classification system. More on that later. It is because of many significant contributors all over the world that fingerprints hold the most important status in forensic science. Over the next several tutorials, we will discuss everything related to fingerprints, including the scientific basis behind the formation of fingerprints on human skin, the mechanism behind fingerprint deposition on a surface, their patterns and types, different classification systems, and most importantly, the various methods of detection and recovery of fingerprints from different surfaces.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.